Covering a lot of ground. One of the things I love about Tears for Fears, I feel like there isn't something that you can't at least attempt to try and make your own. How did you end up with the songs that you ended up from? And what was the overarching experience if it wasn't in a room with a bunch of new songwriters? Was it just a focused writing session between the two of you? Like, how did it happen?
Well, that was varied. I mean, we finished those writing sessions. And like I said, we sat down to try and forge a path forward. And so what we initially did was go back over the songs we already had and the things that we had written and realized that there were some there that we definitely wanted to use, whether the recordings were right or not, and most of them weren't completely right, and we changed those to a certain degree to bring them up to date with the new material we were thinking of recording. So we had five songs, and the key then was to go and find the other however many, I mean, it ended up being another five, that made the album a complete journey. So for us, I think choosing them, I mean, it's not till the end of an album that you realize when you put it together that you have everything you need.
Yeah.
When you're there and
you hope you have everything. Well,
exactly. You hope you have everything, but you don't know until you're done.
Yeah.
Because you want to get to the end of an album and have that feeling of
completion.
Wow. Yeah, we did. You know, and done.
And that's you've got two people to satisfy in that demand. And I think one of the things about any band, pulling it away from this kind of micro-focus of Tears for Fears and the challenge and triumph you've been through, any collaborative or artistic experience or relationship is going to go through the disconnection, the dysfunction. It's part of it. Mm-hmm. How challenging was it for the two of you to come together, not with anyone else around, and feel like equal voices were being heard, and it wasn't, as it had been in the past, according to some reports and interviews, more you in this case or more you over here doing this thing, and a separation occurs?
We have worked in teams before, Kurt and I. I mean, obviously, we started off the two of us. We worked in a team to make songs from The Big Chair. There were five very important people for that record, the engineer, producer Chris Hughes, Ian Stanley, keyboard player and co-writer. That has been successful, extremely successful. But there are moments in our career and in our lives where we are best left just the two of us.
And we sat down and decided, again, how do we get this, finish this album? And we ended up doing that sort of one writing session in my house in Los Angeles, beginning of 2020. Roland went back to London, to England, and the pandemic hit, so he couldn't come back for quite a while. So we were doing things sort of via email. And eventually, Roland got back, I think, at the beginning of September or late August, somewhere around there in 2020. So we went in the studio in September, and by Christmas we finished.
Wow.
That's how quick it was when we were left to our own devices.
Okay, the obvious question from a lifelong fan, I get to ask it because I've been with you all the way along, and I was crestfallen when you no longer were in the band, when there was a time when I felt like at your peak success.
Happy days.
Yeah, well, for me, I mean, and it's funny because, again, I remember the, you know, it's whenever people talk about it, you know, breakups and bands or whatever, and it's because we hold you so dear, right? It's because you give us this gift and we want it to carry on because it fills the gaps in our lives, you know, it gives us this joy that we need and it helps us cry when we need to. And so when we lose that, it's like it's a real mourning that goes on in it.
Yeah.
And so when that happened, I couldn't understand how a band finishes making a record themselves, which is what every band aspires to achieve, is to be able to do that, have it be as successful as it was, and then decide that this is no longer tenable. So I never got to the point of how that happened. And now that you're both in front of me and seeming so united, it's just fascinating to me why that would have happened.
Well, the way we explain it is...
it was natural, I think.
You're seeing four guys who were incredibly successful, who had grown up together, joined at the hip. But there's something that happens psychologically, I think, when you get to around the age of 28, 28 and a half, 29. We call it the Saturn return. In astrology, something had to shift, something had to change. We'd done the 10 years together and we were in bands from the age of 14. So that was at that point in time, half our lives.
Yeah.
And so there is a natural thing. I mean, the acrimony, I mean, that's all a little bit, that's childish. But then it happened with the Beatles as well, exactly the same thing.
Well, see, the Beatles thing is fascinating though, because, and I take your point with Saturn's return because I'm been through it.
No, I've twice. We've done twice.
Yeah,
two
I
rings.
Think I've done. I think I might have done twice
no,
now
you
as well.
No,
must be close. I must be close. I'm not too far away. But I definitely, I remember very clearly what I was going through at the time that it hit me, yeah. and what I was listening to. I found my album. I found my band. Thank God, and that really helped me. But you know, I think about that Beatles experience and what was going on there as well. See, my theory is that McCartney was just on this creative tear.
Yeah, incredible.
Like creative tear. And he was writing these songs that had become like these timeless classics, and everyone else is reading the sports pages in the Daily Telegraph. And it's almost like, and you got John who's in love. He's like, I'm too busy being in love.
Yep.
And George is like, I want to be John. And Paul's like, I want John. And Ringo's stoned. And so between the four of them, just trying to figure his outer space. So it was just this whole creative thing. And did it get to the point where you were going in different directions creatively and it wasn't just the natural astrological separation?
I mean, that's hard. It's hard to tell. I mean, maybe.
Because I saw you as equals big time on those records.
I don't think we ever found out creatively what it meant. I mean, for me, it was more personal than creative. And I felt that it was time for us, or certainly for me, to try and find out who I was as an individual. See, right. This is the problem when you're in a band, you know, in our case, a duo, but, you know, any band, you are that guy.
Yep.
You're that guy from Tears for Fears, you know, and then, and when you've been doing it just, just the two of us for the amount of time we had since we were 14, you're kind of connected at the hip, and you really, at that age, need to go out and find who you are.
You get the anonymity that you crave.
I mean, I remember all the hysteria in the 80s, and it's like, hysteria is, it's manufactured, and it comes from distance and space. You know, I am the sacred object, you must not touch me, okay? So if you kind of go, well, actually, you know what? I'm not the sacred object, and you can touch me, and you can talk to me. And once you do that, you start to relate to fans on the same level.
Yeah.
Then all the hysteria goes away. And then there's a hugely important, a far more important connection to people than this kind of fake stuff.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't really care, you know.
Well, and you couldn't really afford to care about being pop stars because you were the weirdest successful band.
Yeah. Yes.
I think back now to how music translated and having number one albums, selling millions of copies and being courted left, right and center. And you were not making records that were playing the game.
No, I don't think so. I mean, we made records that we liked. So that was the key, you know, for us.
So Kurt, what happens when you make The Hurting, which you like, which is a strange and absolutely anxiety-inducing port, you know, travel yeah. through someone's pain, goes on to break you as a band?
It was strange because we never actually thought, I mean, going back there, we never thought Mad World was really going to be a hit. We thought it would give us some credibility. Also for us, you know, when we became big and, you know, with songs of The Big Chair even bigger, we realized you can't equate fame with happiness, for one thing.
Yep.
We managed to separate music from our life.
We did at that point in time, yes. Well, no, eventually we did.
I listened back to Big Chair and I, what really strikes me again, getting back to the weirdness of it, is just how some of the arrangements and the musicality of that album connected on such a mass level. Shout's a weird song in itself, but it's a perfect pop song.
Yeah.
You know, talking to my wife about it the other day, I was like, this is just so flawless. But then you listen to like Head Over Heels. Not just that piano riff, which became so iconic overnight. I remember being a rap fan and hearing DJ Cash Money loop that, and that was the start of his DJ set back in the 80s, and it was like it was embraced. But just the sound, this is where I... Warning, this is super granular, nerdy, super fan. But just the sound of the piano, it became something that was iconic within your sound and within your catalog. And looking back on that now, can you just tell us a story about making Head Over Heels? Because it's really one of those moments.
Because we were making sort of quite advanced electronic music, this pop song came along and it was like, well, what do we do with it?
Yeah.
We haven't got a clue. So we were struggling. We had the bass part, which sounded great. You know, it's one of those songs which we didn't really particularly like. But when we play it live, we get to the end of the set. It doesn't matter what song you play before it, how big that song is. When that intro kicks in,
yeah.
the audience goes crazy.
It is
it's
so
fantastic.
Iconic. That piano is so iconic. Where were you when that was written and how did that little piano riff?
Well,
it deserves
on,
some attention.
Didn't it start on tour?
It may have started on tour, maybe a 1983 Where You Are tour.
Well, I mean, I think especially with Head Over Heels, strangely, and we weren't big fans of the song to start with because, I don't know, it seemed too simplistic to us. Because it really is just a simple love song.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what it is. And in general, that's not what we gravitate towards, as you could probably guess.
You two are writers. It's got to come from in here, right? But sonically, and the idea of moving in different spaces and doing different things, you're perfectly positioned because, and you've acknowledged this before, so I'll acknowledge it again, you know, you are 100% a contemporary touchstone for some of the most really innovative modern artists. Like, Abel doesn't fuck around. You know, he's one of the greats, and I've spoken to him about you. We've had the Tears for Fears conversation. So I wonder whether or not that kind of opens up the scope of what's possible now that you've been able to reunite and do what you always did best, come from inside out, what out feels like to you going forward.
What's interesting about the Able thing, and, you know,
is that a question? I don't even know if that was a question. It felt like a question.
But what's interesting?
You're just a poet. It's
good, right?
Remarkable.
It was all right.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's incredible.
It's all right.
I mean, the interesting thing about the Able thing, and you know, going on from there, Kanye or Drake, whomever may sample our stuff.
Do you see what he just did? Yo, check it out!
Yeah, that was so good! That was the greatest flex of all time! I'm so sorry, but there's no f***ing way I'm letting you get away with that. That was like, whether it's the Able thing or it's the Kanye or the Drake thing, whoever sampled it. That was epic!
I hate to brag. Obviously, Abel was a big fan, say. So then management, you know, and record company, you need to work with these people.
Yeah.
But they
10x on what you've already got, everybody, simply by getting in the room with him. I get it. It's so gross.
Which is ridiculous, because the reason, you know, they've used our music is because of us, because we did the music. Yeah. It's not, you know, I don't think working with them makes things any better. I think that
unless it's organic, unless you meet and you realize,
well, yeah,
there's something that can be done naturally,
maybe, but, you know, I think that's difficult. The reason we've been sampled or been used and been covered by various people is because they appreciate what we do.